गुड मॉर्निंग ऑल. आई सी ए सचिन मिनियार ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ सारसबाग सिटी स्टडी सर्कल ऑफ WRC वेलकम आर टुडे स्पीकर सी ए कुसाई गोसाई गोवा वाला एंड आर पैनलिस्ट सी ए पराग प्रांसपे एंड सी ए जगदीश डोंगरे सर एंड ऑल मेंबर्स टू दिस सेशन ऑन अकाउंटिंग स्टैंडर्ड 10 फॉर स्पेशली इम्प्लीकेशन फॉर नॉन कॉर्पोरेट एंटिटीज. Before we start with the session, I would request Dongre sir to address members. Over to you, Dongre sir.
Good morning, all the participants. As most of you are aware that the ICAI has prescribed some revised guidelines for the applicability of the accounting standards to MSMEs and non-corporate entities. There are four levels, level one, level two, level three, and then MSMEs. These applicability of these accounting standards for non-corporate entities, that is the revised guidelines, are applicable from the financial year 2021. So this is the quite right time to have this session on this topic, because soon we are going to sign and finalize the tax audit report of non-corporate entities and other entities, sole proprietor, partnership, etc. Even though the tax audit is not applicable, sometimes we have to audit the books of accounts of the sole proprietors, partnership, etc. for bank loan purpose, etc. So we have to keep in mind these revised guidelines or revised applicability of the accounting standards to non-corporate entities. Most of you are aware that the first session in this regard was taken by respected Dhavre sir. That is, he has discussed the general guidelines, general applicability of the various accounting standards to non-corporate entities. During that session, it was decided or it was interacted between the members that some specific standards we should cover on this topic, that's their applicability to the non-corporate entities. So accordingly, because for level one for non-corporate entities, the applicability, the accounting standard is same as the corporate entities. But for level two, three, four, there are certain carve outs. Regarding the applicability, there are some concessions or exemptions as far as recognition, measurement, and disclosure. So that needs some discussion. And today we have Kusai Goawala sir on being the session, being the panelist for this particular session. I also request, because yesterday there was a interactive meeting between the Central Council member CA Chandrasekhar Chittaye and the various representatives of the study circle, and it was decided that in the study circle the member should also come forward for taking up the various sessions, because that is for which the study circles are meant for. So I request all the members, if they wish to take any session on any other accounting standard with special emphasis to applicability of the non-corporate entities or for any other topic, they may contact Sachin, Parag, or to me, so that we can take up that session. So with this background, I request CA Parag Paranspe to introduce Kusai Goawala ji, today's speaker. Over to you, Parag.
Yeah, good morning, Jagdish sir. Good morning, Sachin sir. And good morning, Kusai Goawala sir. Welcome, sir. I'll just introduce a brief profile of CA Kusai Goawala. He's a fellow member of our Institute of Chartered Accountants of India and is qualified in 1986 and has a rich experience of 35 years. He's a partner of GK, DJ and Associates. He was recently nominated for 3 years for Ind AS Implementation Committee of WRC of ICAI. That's a biggest achievement. He's presently nominated on the research committee of WRC of ICAI for the financial year 2021. He has also conducted numerous lectures on various topics like tax audit, IFRS, Ind AS, accounting standards, auditing standards, ICDS, company law, and in the seminars conducted by CA, CS, and CME institutes. He was a part of the group which authored the guidance note on internal audit of automobiles industry published by ICAI. He was also part of a group which compiled various books published by CA Institute on Office Management Manual for CA in Practice, Procedural Guidelines for Ease in Incorporation of Company, and Procedural Guide for Registration and Modification of Charge. I welcome CA Kusai Goawala, sir, and request him to start his proceedings for the day. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Parajji. Thank you, Jagdish ji, Sachin ji, and all the other committee members of Sarasbagh CP Circle for inviting me to this particular seminar and addressing this and addressing the members. Very good morning to all of my fellow professional chartered accountants and the members of this study circle. Today, we are going to discuss certain aspects relating to accounting standards applicable to non-corporate MSME. And before we go into this particular topic, let me just share with you some few aspects concerning why this particular topic is very important and why you all should attend this seminar and why you should hear me for you on a very beautiful Saturday morning. First of all, we know there are many practitioners, chartered accountants who are practicing all over the country, where there sometimes there are so many practitioners whose focus mainly is on a tax. They are either compliance or filing of returns or, you know, compliance with a tax. So their focus is mainly on tax. They sometimes, you know, they don't give much importance or weightage which is required to be given on accounting standards. I will give you one simple, one joke, you know, which is circulating on various WhatsApp group. Is there was one patient who went to a doctor and he said, "I have got some problem in my stomach. I have got some pain." The doctor examined him and he says, "You have a very typical problem." Patient was a little worried. I said, "What is my typical problem?" The doctor said, "Look, in my examination, whatever problem you have, I had taken as an option. I had never studied that." So similarly, some people consider accounting standard as option. So, okay, ye itna critical nahi hai, usko ignore karo, apna focus khali tax pe rakho. Let me share with you one very important aspect. All the members, I'm not trying to scare you, but I'm trying to tell you something very important, that whoever now is going to sign or attest any financial statements have to be very, very careful, because if you are not going to comply with accounting standards, you are in for a big, big trouble, because the things have changed. Of course, it was that way earlier also, but things have become more stricter now. You are all aware what is happening around. You are hearing about a lot of news. The department, the CBDT, has given clear instructions to the commissioners of income tax that if they find any errors in the tax audit report or the financial statements, if they are not complying with various provisions of law or whether accounting standards, they should immediately file a complaint with the disciplinary committee of the ICAI. And ICAI is flooded with several such disciplinary, you know, action for against the members who have not complied with accounting standards. So accounting standards should not be taken lightly. It is the very basis and the fundamental, you know, aspect concerning accounts. Now, you will say, what is the need? Why do you need to have accounting standards? What is the need? I mean, let's go to the basic part of it. Why do you need accounting standards? It brings about a uniformity into the accounts all across the spectrum. So all the accounts are at the same platform, and then you can compare those accounts properly. If it was not maintained, I mean, the accounting standards were not mandatory, or if it was not required, everybody would have, you know, used his own mind, used his own creative ideas, and, you know, prepared accounts the way they wanted to do it. And there would not have been any comparability. Plus, you could not have understood what exactly is the profit or loss. So you would have, you know, accepted whatever the figures are there, and there was no true and fair basis of that accounts. So in order that the accounts show true and fair, the standards are very important, and standards have to be incorporated in the, it have to be, you know, incorporated in the financial statement. Otherwise, your financial statements will not be true and fair. And if you are signing that particular financial statement, you are risking your entire certificate, which you have so meticulously and with so much of hard work you have earned and you have achieved, and it will just go in one small mistake and you can lose the certificate. I'm telling you, it is a very, very scary thing, and it is happening now, because we have to maintain highest level of our professional standards, and you have to, you know, uphold the name of our chartered accountant. And if to do that, we have to be updated with all these accounting standards. We need to incorporate those in our financial statements. I will give you a very simple example. You know, I have come across many balance sheets prepared by several people, several professionals, audited and signed by several professionals. Sometimes I find in the, you know, notes to accounts, a very simple one line of accounting policy which says depreciation has been provided as per income, as per the rate provided under income tax and rates and method provided under Income Tax Act 1961. Well, if you are writing that note, that means you have not complied with the accounting standard in your financial statement. And if you have audited that particular financial statement, then your accounts are not true and fair. Why? If you look at the income tax method of depreciation, it is only an incentive. Income tax depreciation is an incentive. It is not the real method. You see the way the depreciation is computed in income. It's a block method. It's a khichdi. It's a tapela. All everything put together in a block. Any sale, you credit the sale proceeds to that block. How can it be? How can that be the accounting? It is an incentive based system. That okay, the government wants to give you an incentive to get some tax benefit. That is the reason. Depreciation as per IT Act is not the accounting method. The accounting method is as per the useful life, how you have to apportion the depreciation as per the useful life. Even under non-corporates where Schedule 2 is not applicable, you are required to work out depreciation as per useful life method and provide in the books of accounts. Yes, in your computation, you add back that depreciation and you did claim depreciation as per IT Act. That is fine. That is a computation. But as far as the books are concerned, when you are saying true and fair, you cannot apply the whatever depreciation is there in the Income Tax Act, you straight away put it into your P&L account. That is absolutely wrong. If you do that, then you are into big, big trouble. Now, of course, you may say there is no impact on tax because it is any case added back, but that is not the factor. Because once you are saying true and fair, that financial statement may be good enough for the tax purposes because it has got tax neutral. It has no impact on tax. But somebody might be investing in the business based on your financial statement. Some partners are coming in, some partners are going out. They are using this financial statement for the purpose of computing their share of profit or their capital balance. And if your figures are not correct, and the depreciation as per IT Act and depreciation as per books can vary a lot. We ourselves, when we do our financial audit and we find a lot of gap between what is there in the accounts and what is there as per IT Act. So when we add back and do that, there is of course a deferred tax component also in that. So there is a lot of difference. And if there is a difference, that means that person's profit or loss which has been booked in this capital account is wrong. And once that happens, it is possible that a partner may say that you have cheated me or you have not given the true accounts. And the always, in whenever there is a fight between the partners, it is the auditor who becomes a scapegoat. And because they know it's very easy to fight against an auditor because simply one run letter to the institute and is gone. Whereas between the partners, they will have to fight 10 years in the court. So we have to be very, very careful when we are signing any financial statements. And particularly, don't take things lightly. Kya isme kya farak padta hai? Isme na koi tax ka implication nahi hai. Income tax par koi farak nahi padta. Income tax par shayad farak nahi padega. But there could be other outsiders who are looking at the financial statement. This firm might have borrowed money from the bank. So the bank mein particular financials ja raha hai. So that profit or loss is wrong. And if that is subsequently found out to be wrong, you will be in big trouble because bank has lent the money based on the financial statement which you have audited and signed. And tomorrow, you know how these things are happening. Banks are always after somebody to blame. And they will say, oh, the auditors have made a mistake. That is the reason we lost our money. Now penalize the auditors. So, and how much fees you will take, maybe a few lakhs rupees, but we are responsible for the crores of rupees of borrowing. Imagine that. See, today, you know, all these things are reported in newspaper every day. A lot of such cases are happening from the bank side. So if there is any error, if there is a default from the customer, the auditor is a scapegoat. So we have to be very careful that we have to comply strictly with all our accounting standards, not only accounting standards, but even auditing standards also, because our files should be, I'm deviating slightly from the topic, but I'm tempted to say that because sometimes, we take things for granted and we don't, do documentation properly and then we are in big, big trouble. So accounting standards, particularly this even PPE AS10 is also a very important standard. Although you may say that what impact it has got in tax, it is as per depreciation, as per IT Act, it has no relevance for the accounts. But yes, it has got huge relevance for the accounts. We should take care very seriously. and I'm sure all the members will take this, you know, in a proper perspective. Now, what constitutes Indian GAAP? You all are aware. Indian GAAP is basically all your accounting standards, guidance note, or whatever are the various notes issued, circulars issued by our institute, and all these guidances form part of the, like, for example, for companies, a Schedule 3 is also a part of the Indian GAAP. So all that thing forms part of the Indian GAAP, and we are required to comply with this Indian GAAP, and all this, then only we can say it is true and fair. Now, who prescribes accounting standards? Of course, as far as initially it was our institute, which was primarily prescribing accounting standards, but now there has been even NACAS, which has been given responsibility to prescribe accounting standards. Of course, they are in consultation with ICAI because they are the experts in accounting and setting up standards. So it is with their collusion and collaboration that they set the standards. Now, to whom it is applicable? This is the most important question. When sometimes I have come across many situations that many chartered accountants feel that, oh, this accounting standard is not applicable to non-corporates. It's applicable only to corporates under the schedule, under the Companies Act, where there is a requirement, companies accounts rules, where it says that, yes, you are required to comply with accounting standards, but I do not agree. It is not correct statement. Accounting standards are applicable to all the entities. Of course, there are certain carve-outs, certain exemptions given to a non-corporate MSMEs, which we will be discussing little in short today. And we will be discussing in detail one very important accounting standard, AS 10PP. So accounting standard is applicable to all. It is not that you only it is applicable to corporates. It is applicable even to non-corporates. But there are certain relaxations because why there's a relaxation? See, if you have heard me earlier, my approach is concept driven. It's not just to bombard you with some theory and saying, okay, this is what it is. It's not that way. I will try to explain you the why of each and every aspect so that you can remember for life instead of just for 1 hour or two hours which you are hearing me. Why this non-corporates have been given some exemption or certain relaxation? Because even ICAI or even other stakeholders feel that corporates have a higher level of professional management and ability to have resources to be able to comply with complex accounting standards. Whereas non-corporates at a smaller level, they are more family driven, and they don't have those kind of professional expertise available with them, and it's expensive also because to have those kind of professional consultancy, it is very expensive, and their business may not be able to afford those kind of fees. So then they said, okay, for certain complex perspective, which may not be really applicable to them, they have been given certain exemption. But this exemption is given only where there is no public exposure, when there is a minimum public exposure. But when there is a higher level of public exposure, like bank borrowings or anything like that, then the exemptions are minimum, because when there is a public exposure, public money at risk, they do not want to take chances with non-disclosure of accounting standards or non-compliance with accounting standards, because it is the accounting standards which will give a proper shape to the profit and loss account and give a correct view, correct result of the profit and loss. Otherwise, without accounting standards, things can be changed, deviated, and true figures may not come out correctly, and that there would be some loss to the public money. So that they want to avoid. So wherever there is a higher level of public exposure, their compliance is much more stricter. Where there is no public exposure, suppose if it's a family proprietary partnership concern, where it is a small unit and there is no bank borrowing, there is no such turnover which is very high, then there are high level of exemptions, and you can do a very simple compliances and still be able to say that, yes, I have complied with accounting standards. So there are relaxations given to those small and medium enterprises where compliance cost is very expensive. Now, if you see the accounting standards, I mean, I'll just quickly take you to a small two-minute journey of accounting standard. Initially, when 27 accounting standards were in vogue, they were primarily Indian origin. But now with the IFRS coming in as an Ind AS, the government wanted ultimately Now, I have, you know, Ind AS is applicable only to the large companies, you know, those listed companies or those having net worth about 250 crore and all those kind of things. So where the large companies are now complying with Ind AS, they wanted that this should, Ind AS should become the normal standard in our Indian culture, but it will take time because it is complex. There are so many provisions which are very complicated and you need a high level of professional expertise to comply with those standards. So which maybe these non-corporates or MSME may not have this muscle. But if you see the trend, most of the accounting standard, which is Indian based, are now gradually moving towards, have been modified or been amended to slightly gradually moving towards Ind AS. Now, if you see your PPE, which has been amended, so many points of Ind AS have been incorporated. IFRS has been incorporated. So gradually they are bringing you closer to the bridge, they're bridging the gap. And maybe after a few years, when we are all ready, this gap will not be there and we will all be following Ind AS over a period of several years. So we are getting ready for that slowly, gradually. So we don't even come to know when we will be bridging that gap. So I will explain you how this PPE is bridging that gap of IFRS and how IFRS provisions have been incorporated in PPE. And it is now mandatory for all. It is not that there is no exemption for MSME. Of course, there are certain exemptions, but certain points are not exempted. You have to comply. Now, what is SME? Now, SME, there are two levels of definition. We will go into detail of each and every aspect. One definition under SME is for a corporate. Now, in the corporate, there are either an SMC, that is a small and medium company, or a non and small medium. There are no two, only there are two levels. Level which is a non-SMC and one is SMC, the simple, as simple as that. Whereas for non-corporates, earlier there were three levels, level one, level two, level three. Somewhere in March 2021, Institute has introduced a new circular which says that you have to have four levels of MSME. Of course, the first level is not an MSME, it is a normal entity which has got a high level turnover and all that and is applicable. The next three levels, they have given some relaxation because there are medium and small enterprises. And of course, the level four has got the maximum number of relaxation. So that level four is the level where there is a minimum public exposure and there is mainly a family type organization where it is a proprietary or a partnership firm having a small turnover, like a shopkeeper or something where you cannot possibly comply with all those standards. So there is a minimum compliance required. We will discuss those in detail. Now, what are we going to discuss today? We are going to discuss AS 10 property, plant and equipment. Let me just take you to the little background of this standard. Initially, there were two standards which were applicable, AS 6 and AS 10. Now, AS 6 was dealing with depreciation purely and AS 10 was dealing with only fixed assets. It was clearly fixed assets. They have modified this to property, plant and equipment, and it has now got incorporated depreciation provisions also. So AS 6 has now been deleted and it has got merged with your AS 10. Now, as I told you earlier, in this IFRS provisions are getting incorporated into our normal standards. This is one. This is one example of that. In our IFRS, there is IS 16, which deals with PP. The name also is property, plant and equipment, and it deals with both. It deals with the assets, it deals with the depreciation. So the same concept has now come into Indian standards also, which as the name is AS 10 instead of that is IS 16 has become AS 10 in India. So now this standard is applicable to most of the entities and there are only some few relaxation given, which we will discuss. Now, as I didn't know about this, but just I was told that Zavres has already discussed this classification and levels. So I don't want to waste your time repeating on all this, but just quickly, I will take you through that. So in case if anybody wants a revision, it can be revised. But I'm sure you all must be aware about this, but it will quickly glance through it. And we will also share, I will focus more on the AS 10. As I mentioned to you that ICI has recently announced in this council meeting in March, 18th, 19th of March, 21, they have announced a new classification of SME, which is into four categories, level one, level two, level three, level four. Now, as I again said, question why? Why? Because earlier the level three were of a little lower level. I mean, lower level in a sense, the level one started with 50 crores so that the, you know, compliances for higher level companies, entities was in the full bracket. So there was very difficult. Now the turnover criteria has also increased because what was 50 crores some few years back has become 100 crores. So people feel that, oh, you know, we are still in the same level, but we have to comply with more accounting standards. So in that situation, they have reclassified the levels. So people at a very high level of, you know, turnover or borrowing, where they can definitely afford a professional expertise. Like, for example, a company having a turnover of 20 to 50 crore and plus, or a borrowing of 50 crore plus, definitely will have the muscle and the wherewithal or the resources to be able to employ professionals in their company or in their entity to, you know, take care of their, I mean, it's no longer a small partnership firm. It although maybe a partnership entity or an LLP, it may not be a corporate entity. It may be a small entity, it may be a non-corporate entity, but it is no longer a small entity because with a turnover of 250 crore, it is some companies are having lower turnover than this partnership firm or something. So you can then afford to comply. It's a large partnership firm. And definitely there is a public exposure of 50 crore in terms of borrowing. So your compliance have to be perfect. Now, who are the level one company securities or debt listed in? Of course, it is not applicable to non-corporate. It is applicable only to, it doesn't apply to non-corporate because it is applicable only to corporate. Or in the process of listing also doesn't apply. Banks normally are never, you know, into that level. Insurance company or financial institution. Now the criteria is turnover in immediately preceding year. Suppose you are looking at the year 2021. Now 2021 is the year in which you will implement this. So you have to look at 1920 financial year. If your turnover has exceeded 250 crore, you will comply with, you will be under level one, even though your turnover in 2021 may not be about 250 crore. But still, when you have crossed 250 crore in the earlier period, you will be under level one and you will follow what is the level one requirement. Borrowing. Now, borrowing at any time during the preceding year. That means if you had borrowed at 1.50 crore during the 1920, but by the time March 20, it has come down to 40 crore. You have repaid some loans. Still, you will be level one because at any point of time during that financial year, earlier financial year, you are above 50 crore, then you are under level one. And these are any one condition. It is not that all the conditions. That means either your turnover was 250 crore or your borrowing was 50 crore. Anyone is satisfied, you are in level one. So it is not required that all the things should be compliant. Anyone can be compliant, you are in level one. Holding and subsidiary may not be applicable because it's applicable to corporate. Level two then starts with 50 CR to 250, which was earlier level one, 50 CR plus, now it has become level two. And the borrowing and including public deposit. Now borrowing does not mean only bank borrowing. It includes public deposit. That means you have taken loan from any outsiders or any friends or relatives. That also will become for the purpose of working out this limit. Now, as I said, why it is required? Because there is a public exposure. When you have borrowed money, that means you have a responsibility to repay those debts. And if your accounts are not proper, then there is a possibility that you might default in this loan. And that person might lose money and that is a public money. So when there is a public interest at large, they want compliance to be much more larger and strict. So if your public borrowings are about 10 crores, but below 50 crore, then you are in the level two. Okay. Now the level three is from 10 CR to 50 CR and the borrowing 2 crore to 10 crore. So level three has got lots of exemption and the last level, which is level four, is in none of the above. Matlab, if your turnover is below 10 crore, it is a small company, a small partnership firm, or a small entity, which is below 10 crore. When I'm referring to company, I would mean entity because I'm very much tuned to corporate. So it comes out as a company, but here when we are looking at non-corporate, it means an entity. So anything below 10 crore would mean a smaller entity, smaller company, smaller partnership firm, and the borrowing below 2 crore is not something very material. So, I mean, you have maximum number of relaxation in the level 4. Only little bit of compliances you might have to do and you can get away with your compliance. Now, what are these all entities? Now, here this is very important. All entities under MSME category level 2, level 3, level 4 will have to disclose in the notes that it is an MSME. And you have to disclose which level you are in, whether you are level 2, level 3, or level 4. And that it has complied with relevant. This is very important. It should come in your notes to account, whichever financial statement you are signing, you must specify which category you that particular entity falls in, and that you are complying with a statement saying that yes, you have complied with this particular relevant applicable AS. Now here I will slightly deviate. Now if you have looked at the format of the audit report, of course the corporate audit report is there, statutory audit report. When you are signing tax audit report, 3CA does not, or 3CB does not give you the flexibility of modifying the report. But if you are giving an audit report for some other purposes, not for tax audit, but for some partner's requirement, they want an audit report. That audit report has to be in the format which is prescribed by our institute. And that specifically asks you a question that whether you have complied with the accounting standard. And if you have not complied, you cannot make a statement that yes, you have complied with it. So when you are making the statement, you must ensure that all the accounting standards applicable to that level of that entity should have been complied with thoroughly. Or if it is non-compliance, you can specify the qualification. There is no harm. See, because compliance of accounting standard is not a responsibility of the auditor. It is a responsibility of the management. We generally think that it is our responsibility. No, our responsibility is to report on that financial statement. We can point out the discrepancy to the management, and if the management feels, no, we are right and what you are saying is not correct, only recourse that an auditor has is to report in his report that, look, these are the things non-compliant with and this is the impact. And if that impact is material and it is, not only material, but it is, persuasive, then you might even say an adverse report. Okay. So that pain you have got in your hand that to qualify that report. But compliance generally is the responsibility of the management, and they are required to see that, ensure that all the accounting standards are complied with. Our role is to check whether they have complied with it. And if they have not, then either you get it corrected, or if they don't agree on correction, then we have to report. So this is a very simple principle we have to follow. Now, what happens when there is a change between the two levels, level 2, 3, 4? Now, suppose from a lower level to you move to the higher level, either of these. Suppose from level 2, you move to level 3, level 3 to level 4. Suppose in the 1 year, let's say year 1, the entity was in the level 2. Now, in year 2, it moves to level 3 because the turnover has increased. Now, you have to immediately comply with the level 3 standards which is applicable. That means what was exempt under for level 3, it was exempt. Now when you're moving to level 2, you will have to start complying with those standards which are applicable to level 2, and the exemption is not available to level 2, which was available to level 3. Now in that situation, you will immediately comply in that year itself. Now you cannot say no, I will wait. No, I cannot. You have to comply in that year itself. Now, what happens to the preceding year? Preceding year, let's say, for example, you are in level 3 in year 1, and you are now in level 2 in year 2. The level 2, whatever is required to be complied with, you will comply. But in the earlier year, you were not required to comply because you were in the level 3. So you had exemption. So now you did not, in the previous figures, you did not restate. That is exemption given. You continue to maintain the preceding figures, whatever it is there. But there will be a note that it has not been modified. Previous year's figures have not been modified. There will be a note to account that there is a change in the level. But due to this particular circular, we are not required to modify the last year's figures. We will maintain as it is. But this year's figures will incorporate what is required for level 2. So if level 2 becomes level 1, then all accounting standards are applicable. So then in that situation, again, you will comply with all the standards which is applicable. And no need to restate the earlier figures, only give a note in the notes to accounts. Now, what happens when you move from a higher level to lower level? Say you are on level 1 earlier or level 2 earlier. Now you have moved to the lower level. That means, see, when I'm saying 2 and 3, 4 are lower level, what I mean by that is that with more relaxation. You are at a higher platform. Now you are moving to a lower platform. So level 1 is a higher platform. Level 2 is higher than 3 that way. So when you are at level one and now next year you feel that no, the turnover has gone down and because of that you are in level two or level three, whatever, from level two to level three, whichever way it goes down the level, you will wait for 2 years. Now in when you are moving up, you don't wait for 2 years. You immediately comply for the whatever the next level compliance is there. But when you're moving down, you will not immediately comply with lower level. You will still continue with the earlier year's level. For example, you were in level one in the year 2021, which is the first year of our implementation. This. In 21-22, you find that the turnover has gone down and now you are in level two. Level two has got some exemptions. Level one never had exemptions. So you will not be eligible for those exemptions. You will continue level one for 2 years. If the next 2 years you still are below that threshold limit and you are still under level two, then from the third year onwards, you will start complying with level two and not level one. So for 2 years, you will wait. That means whether it is a temporary, it will again go up to level one, then you continue to do level one. So no exemption. But if for 2 years, consecutive years, if your turnover is lower or borrowing is lower and you are under level two for two consecutive years, then the third year onwards, you will apply level two. So first 2 years, continue with the level one. Even though your turnover is low, even your borrowing is low, you have repaid all your borrowings, your turnover is drastically low because of this COVID lockdown, all that thing has happened. But you will still comply with level one for 2 years. After 2 years, if you still continue with that same turnover or lower turnover or no borrowing or low borrowing, then you will apply level two or level three or whatever lower level from the next year, third year onwards. But till that time, no. So this is the difference between the rules. When you are moving up, you will immediately, because when it is a higher level compliance, then you cannot wait because it is important. They will not give you 2 years of window period. But when you are moving down, you have to still comply higher level for 2 years. Okay, so this is the rule. Now, certain times there are certain exemptions available, but you feel no. I am a very compliant person, and I would like to be very transparent in my financial statement, and I would like to comply even though I have got exemption. The ICI is giving me exemption. Okay, level three, level four, you do not comply with this, but I still want to do it voluntarily. No harm. You can do it. But you will have to mention in the notes to accounts as to out of 10 exemptions which you are available to you, you have availed, let's say, 5 exemptions and 5 you said I will comply. So which are availed, now that you have to mention, okay, out of 10 which I am eligible, I have availed only 5 exemptions. I am not available for the next remaining 5. So that notes, because person who is reading the financial statement should know what has gone into that, what khichdi has gone into this particular financial statement, but somebody should know. So that is very important, and you should inform by way of notes to accounts. And if you have not availed all the 10 exemptions which are available, you have said, no, I don't want to claim exemption, I will comply with all, like as if level one. Now in that situation, you will give a note, disclose in the notes that yes, I have not complied with any, I mean, I have not availed any exemption. Now, which are the standards not applicable to some levels is level 2, level 3, level 4. Level 1, first of all standards are applicable. So there is no exemption to level 1. So we forget about any exemption to level 1. Level 2, level 3, level 4. There are some standards which you do not comply in totality, like cash flow you will not give, segment reporting you will not give, EPS is not applicable because in any case it is a non-corporate. Consolidated financial statement is not required. Associate is not required. Interim financial statement is not required. Joint venture is not required. Amalgamation not required. It doesn't come because it is a non-corporate. Related party, level 3 and level 4 not applicable. But in case of level 2, yes, you have to comply. Even amalgamation, level 2, level 3, you have to comply. But level 4, it is exempt. Income tax, level 4, deferred tax is exempt. But normal tax, you have to comply. So for level 2 and 3, even deferred tax is applicable. So there is no exemption. Okay. And then deferred tax comes into play when there is a gap in the depreciation. I told you, as per books and as per income tax act. So definitely it implies that you have to provide depreciation under the books, not as per income tax, but as per the useful life. If it was as per income tax, then there is no deferred tax. Discontinued operation, level 3, level 4 is exempt. Impairment of assets, level 4 is exempt. Now, there are certain disclosure relaxation, matlab not fully exempt. These standards are not fully exempt, but there are certain relaxation and in the disclosures. Now, in PP, we will discuss in detail what you are not allowed. I mean, you need not be disclosed for level 3 and 4. For 1 and 2, applicable. But level 3 and 4, you are getting some exemption. Foreign exchange, again, some exemption in disclosures for level 3 and 4. Investments, again, level 4. Employee benefits, lots of exemptions for level 2, 3 and 4. Because employee benefit is a very complex and a complicated standard for you to compute as a smaller entity. So for that, they have given you a lot of exemption. These also, a lot of exemptions are there. Intangible assets, only level 4 co exemption hai. For disclosures, not that it is an entire standard. Is impairment of assets, again, level 2 and 3. There is some exemptions in disclosures. Provisions, again, level 2 and 3 and 4 co. There are some exemptions from disclosures. Now, what are the... Let us take up AS 10 PP, which is very important for us. Today, we are discussing AS 10. So we will take it up in detail. One is that disclosure regarding temporary idle PP. Now, what is this? Let me explain you. I have got a plant running. Out of that, some plant I feel that it is not required as of now, and I put it aside. It is not put to use. It is kept aside. It is not being in use, and it is idle, lying idle in the one workshop. It is there in the factory. It is actually running. It is functional. It is not that it is not working. It is working. But I don't have business for that. I don't have jobs for that. So it is idle. Now, for any person who is reading the financial statement, it is important to know that you are showing your block of, I mean, your assets, PP in your financial statement as 100 crores or 20 crores, 10 crores. Are they all really working or are they really being used? Because that usage is reflected in your turnover. Because when the plant is being used, machineries are being used, you generate business, you generate turnover. But there could be certain portion of machinery which is not being used, it is running idle. This gives an indication to the reader of the financial statement that there is some idle capacity in the company, in the entity, in the factory, where certain machines are not being used. So they will know when they're dealing with the entity, or they are investing in an entity, or they are transacting with the entity, they will know. Even if the bank is giving a loan to this entity, they will know that there are certain idle assets which are not being used. And if that idle assets are substantial in nature in terms of their total asset, they can question the management as to what are we doing about it? Why are they idle? Why are they not getting any output from them? Because their output will increase, their profitability will increase, all that will happen. So this disclosure will open up a Pandora's box. It will lead to a lot of analytical questions and answers, and management will have to answer those. Otherwise it is hidden. Oh, aapke paas 10 crore ke assets hai. Who goes to the factory and see whether they are actually working or not working? From the financial statement, you don't come to know ke bhai aapke out of 20 machines that you have got, only 15 are being put to use, 10 only are put to use, 10 to aise hi par hai. So by disclosing it here in the financial statement, then only the reader of this financial statement will get a correct picture of their operations, and they will come to know, okay, look, this company, either it is working efficiently or not working efficiently. And they can start questioning. Maybe there could be genuine reason. It's not that there is management is just wasting resources, but there may not be any business. There may not be any output. Kya karega? So, okay, they are keeping it idle. So all this analytical review will happen by disclosure. And if disclosure is not made, that means you're hiding something. And hiding something is more dangerous than, being cheat. It's called cheating. So, of course, this particular disclosure is exempted to level 3 and 4 because the risk is low, the impact to the society at large is low. So, okay, that is your internal thing. You know it very well. You don't disclose it. Fully depreciated PP still in use. Now this other way around. In your financial statements, that WDV of that PP is zero. You already depreciated fully, but still working. Very good. You are exploiting that asset much more than what it is supposed to, because the useful life is over. Naturally, when you have depreciated it fully, that means that the useful life is over. But still, like for example, I have got a car which, normally a car will last for 15 years. But if I have maintained it well and I'm using it nicely, I can use it for 20 years, 5 more years I can work. So there is no harm. So, I mean, it is a good thing. It is the efficiency of the management that in spite of having full depreciated, that means all the useful life is over. In spite of that, I'm still able to use this machinery and I'm able to get the output out of this. So it gives a good positive picture to your investors or to the bankers. Say, yes, this management is more efficient, more productively oriented. So this disclosure again is required, but for level 3 and level 4, they said, okay, no need to do. Each revalue class of PPE. Now, you have an option under PPE either to disclose the finance, the plant and plant equipment, property, plant and equipment at the book value, the cost, or at the market value, at the fair value, fair market value. Now, that option, once if you have exercised, you cannot say, I will do pick and choose. Suppose if I have got, buildings and I've got 10 buildings, I can't say, okay, I will revalue only one building. These three buildings may have a value come, so I will not value that. This building has appreciated, so I will only revalue one building. No, you can't do that. You have to do the entire class of asset revaluation, whether it has gone down or it has gone up, doesn't matter. You cannot pick and choose. Okay. So if you have to do, let's say, plant and machinery, or it's a vehicles or computers, everything, the entire class of that particular PPE, you will have to revalue in totality. You cannot say only one part of the particular class of PPE I will revalue. But that disclosure was required for all the levels, but level 3, level 4, they have given exemption. Carrying amount of PPE retired from active use but not held for this. Now here what is happening? There are certain PPE which you are still holding it, you have not sold, you have not disposed it of. But it is retired from active use. Like I told you, idle. There's a difference between idle asset and retired from active use. That do different things. What is the meaning of idle? Machine is working. It's a working condition. And it is still useful life is still balanced. Suppose, for example, you have bought a machine 2 years ago. But today you don't have any orders. So machine is lying idle. But a machine which is fully used up and, you know, depreciated plus uska active life khatam ho gaya hai. But now you want to sell it as a scrap. So you have retired that particular asset. Now it's not giving you production. It is not giving you output. There is some problem. Then that machine has to be kept aside. By now, this is retired from active life. But I am trying to sell. I'm trying to sell it off or whatever. I've kept it aside. That disclosure also is required to know for the person who is reading your financial statement to know how many such assets out of this block is there, which is basically retired and they will be sold out. So the person can read the PPE in the right perspective and get a correct picture of your company's operations rather than giving some rosy, a different picture. Yo, I've got 10 crore of plant, but actually it's 8 crore ka toh plant is retired from active life. So what is left out? So you have to give the value and the correct amount, carrying amount. So what is that carrying amount of PPE which has been retired from active use? Because now you will not get output from them. So you know what is the balance machine which is going to give you output. So you know the capacity of the company. All this is to get analytical review of your financial statements and subsequent projections. Because a bank giving loan or a new partner coming in, all are investing their hard-earned money into the entity. And when they invest this money, they want to see the financial statements correctly, because otherwise they will feel cheated that they have put in money and they have lost money. And when they lose money, who is the first hit? The auditor. Because I have invested money based on reliance of a financial statement. I didn't do any due diligence. I have relied on your financial statement, and the financial statement said that this is what it is. And I when I invested money, I found that this is not the right thing. And you, because of this, I got cheated. So now I have to penalize you. Suppose, for example, if he has invested 20 crores, now he is going to claim 20 crore with all the damages. Now that poor auditor may not have the 20 crore in terms of his assets. His personal assets will go if the claim comes from that investor. So that is the reason I'm saying very important when you are signing on a dotted line on the financial statement, please make sure that all this compliant. You make a disclosure, then it is up to him to decide whether he wants to invest or not to invest. Then it is his problem. Tomorrow, if he has invested based in spite of that disclosure, he cannot tell you that you did not tell me. See, I have told you, you have invested with your open eyes, not that I have cheated you. We have disclosed it correctly. Now it is up to you to take a decision whether you want to invest or not to invest. Then there are other things like AS11. I think I'm not getting into that because I need to start with that important topic of AS10. I am sure this must have already been discussed by Zavra sir. He is much more efficient and much more expert than me. And I respect him as like my teacher and guru. He is a CCM and most respected person in the faculty, today in the faculty and as a chartered accountant. So I'm sure he must have covered all this. I'm not getting into it. If you have got any queries on that, you can, of course, message me. I will reply to that. There are certain disclosures for AS 13, which is exempt. AS 15, there are several such exemptions because they say level, if their employees more than 50 or less than 50. If there are more than 50, then even your certain disclosures are more. If they are less than 50, then even your actual valuation may not be required. So all those things are applicable. Now, AS 19 is a very, again, a complex leasing arrangement. AS 19 is a lease thing where, again, disclosures of a strict financial and operating lease may not be applicable to many of those smaller entities. So level 2 and 3, 4, a lot of disclosure exemptions are given. AS 26 is intangible assets. Again, similar disclosure, what was there for tangible assets have been given. So that again, because it is in the line of tangible asset, which PPE we looked at. Impairment of assets, again, level 2, level 3, there are certain exemptions. Now, when we come to AS 29, again, the disclosures of how that movement of provision is there is exempt for level 2, 3, and 4. So not very material, not very significant. So they have done away with disclosures so that it makes life easier for the MSME so that you don't have a burden of huge compliances and the cost associated with it. Now we will go to this very important topic, which many people ignore it. And let me share with you. It is very, very important aspect, AS10, property, plant and equipment. And when you have to sign off as a true and fair, then you need to understand AS10. Without that, your financial statement cannot be true and fair. If you're doing only tax practice, only filing returns, then probably this may not apply to you. But when you are signing off a financial statement in any manner, whether it was tax audit or in some another audit for the bank purposes or for any other purposes, for investment purposes, then compliance with AS10, property, plant and equipment should not be taken lightly because there are huge number of changes which has happened. See, we were all used to a very old accounting standard 10, which was a very simple accounting standard. Just simply work out how to work out the carrying amount and bringing in the books fixed assets, which was very simple. Anything that is any cost that is incurred to bring that asset to its place of this and making it working condition. So that was our basic understanding of AS10 initially, but that has undergone a drastic change, a sea change, a U-turn, I would say. And that is the reason I selected this topic because this is one of my favorite topics, AS10. It has got ingrained IFRS. That's the reason it is more important to discuss because MSME and IFRS are two different things. First of all, IFRS itself is a very complex phenomena. I don't believe it. I feel it is simple, but general belief it is that it is very complex. People are thinking, oh, it is IFRS, but some Greek and Latin, but I don't think that way. But bringing that IFRS into AS10, which is applicable to all the entities, is a challenge. Because MSME, first of all, will not understand IFRS. And okay, to implement AS10 with an IFRS factor into it is a challenge. So I will, as my normal approach is to make things simple. I don't want to make it very complicated because after one half an hour or 45 minutes, which we will be discussing, I believe you should get a fairly good idea of what I'm trying to explain and what the standard requires to do. And if I have done that, I think I've achieved my purpose. Otherwise, it's a waste of time. First of all, I don't want to spend more time on what was already earlier there, but just to revise what was there, property, plant and equipment basically is a tangible item. Intangible is a separate standard, AS26, so we are not dealing with it. We are dealing with tangible, which you can touch, which you can see physically available, like plant, property, equipment. Intangibles are those like software, goodwill, all those things which you cannot touch, you cannot see, but it's still productive. it's still giving you the profit. These are those assets which gives you profit, but which you can see physical. Are held, see the distinction between PPE, inventory, investment, very important distinction. Otherwise, you may wrongly classify a certain asset as an investment or an inventory or a PPE. But for classifying it as a PPE, what is the criteria? That asset itself is not going to be sold to get revenue. That asset will be used in the production or supply of goods or services or rentals to others for administrative purposes. So these are the very clear-cut boundaries of what is a PPE. Now, inventory mein kya hota hai? That asset itself is going to be sold for generating revenue. Here, when you are buying a plant, that plant is not going to be sold for generating revenue. If you are dealing in machines, then machine is not a PPE, it is an inventory. If you are buying and selling machines, then it is not an PPE, it is an inventory, because it is the machine itself will be sold to generate revenue. So it is an inventory, although for some other person, it will be a PPE, because for them, that machine is used to produce goods or services which will generate revenue. So it is machine per se is not going to be sold, but machine will generate revenue for the organization. Either by way of rental, for example, if you have got a property which is rented out, it will generate revenue. So it is also a PPE. Now, if a machine also can be rented out, it is a PPE. Or for administrative purpose, suppose you have got a building, fixed building which you are using for your own office. Now you are not, see, you are not doing for production. But does that mean it is not a PPE? No, it is a PPE, because when you are working in the office and doing office administration work to produce, it is also an ancillary activity for production. Production is going on in factory, in the office, whatever decisions are being taken, that is impacting your production, because your purchase orders, your purchase planning, your financial planning, financial management, all this is directly impacting your production. So naturally, production or services, whatever services you are rendering. Even the administration, what you are doing is also related to your production activity. So it is not that it is just for administration. So it is not a PPE. No, it is a PPE because it is linked to your production or your services. And of course, the criteria is that particular asset or PPE to be qualified as a PPE, it should have a life which is more than 12 months. Suppose something which is going to be exhausted within less than 12 months, it is not a PPE. It will be written off as in the P&L account, profit and loss. It will never be capitalized as an asset, because it is assumed that it has a life which is beyond 12 months. Now they have added from IFRS, and under IFRS there is an IS 40 which deals with agriculture. Okay, India is a primarily agrarian economy. Substantial portion of our economy is by agriculture. You know, there are so many crops and all that we have got. We never have a standard on agriculture. IFRS has a standard on agriculture. Now, gradually, they are bringing some standard in PPE to match with IFRS. As I said, we are bridging the gap. So first, they have introduced in PPE a small section called bearer plants. Okay, this is a bearer plant which has come up in AS10. Now, what is a bearer plant? See, in the IFRS, if you look at it, it is a much wider term, biological asset. Biological asset is a wider term. It has got all crops, even the crops in the field, maize, wheat, all that also was covered. But in AS10, they have not covered entire thing, because that goes under the normal revenue. So it goes under agriculture standard, which is not yet being incorporated in our standard. They have only brought in a portion of it which deals with property. A plant. So a bearer plant is a plant. Now, what is the meaning of plant? I will give you a simple example which you will understand what I mean. See, when you have to distinguish between the two types of products, agricultural crops. One is the crops which grow in the field, which is wheat or maize, which is cultivated, and that crop is over next year again, or next season they again harvest it. So they again have a new crop coming up. Okay, every year there is, or every 6 months or whatever is the season, they harvest crop and they remove it, they cultivate and they sell. So it is finished. We are not dealing with those crops. Okay. There is another type of plant, which is a tree or some kind of a plant, which does not buy itself is sold. Okay, like not like a grain or maize or something which itself can be sold. It's a tree, like a mango tree. Give me a very simple example, mango tree. We all know it. Mango tree will take several years to start giving fruits. But once it starts giving fruit, it gives fruit for so many years. Maybe 10 years, 15 years, depending on the depending on the type of tree or where it is situated. So it is a plant. Okay, it is not a crop which can be removed and finished. The tree will remain for several years. It will still bear plant fruit every season, and then you can yield results from that every year. So that becomes a plant. Now, what is the criteria for that? It should be used in the production or supply of agricultural produce. Yes, it produces mangoes or whatever crop it, whatever fruits it bears. Expected to bear fruit produced for more than 12 months. Naturally, mangoes are for more than 5 years, 10 years, so it is more than 12 months. Has a remote likelihood of being sold as agriculture. That means that tree itself will never be sold, except ultimately when you will cut that tree later on after it has completed its useful life, and it, then you can use it for some timber or whatever. That is the last stage. But what you generate is very nominal, not substantial. So we are not going to use that tree itself as a sale product. Okay, what are we going to use? The fruits of that as a sale product. So that becomes a bearer plant. Now, how are you going to bring it in the books? There are so many companies in India and so many entities in India who have this plantation, but they were never so far brought in the books of accounts. Only the whatever crops they get, whatever fruits they get, they are sold and it is shown as a sales in the book. But the item which is generating this revenue is never brought in the books. So your financial statements do not reflect where is that asset which is generating this revenue. So now you have to bring in that asset how will you bring it? Now, what is the cost of, you're not going to buy some trees at some 1 lakh rupees or 2 lakh rupees, you're going to grow. So you might buy a sapling for that, you might cultivate, you might put in some manure, you will put some time to some labor for, watering it and all. So that is the cost of this bearer plant. And that cost has to be capitalized as a PP and show it as a mango tree or whatever. Cultivation, or then that becomes a plant for you, and it continues in the books, and it will be depreciated as per the useful life of that particular plant. Recognition of item of PP when probable future economic benefit. For this is the standard which you all know it from beginning. If you do not have any economic benefits, you cannot recognize an PP. You have to write off as an asset. As an expense, you cannot continue as a, because it should be able to get an economic benefit. Measurement, what is the measurement? Initially, when you bring in the item in the books, it has to be always at cost. It cannot be at the fair market value initially, because ultimately, of course, when it comes in your books, it is coming at the fair market because you have bought it at the fair market value. So it's assumed that it is a FMV and it will be recognized at the cost. Now, even for the bearer plant, the same, whatever it's initially the cost of constructing that PP, you will have to recognize in the books of account. Whatever saplings you bought, whatever manure you put in and all that, that become the your cost of that particular PP. Now, there is one very interesting catch here. What is the cost? Now, this has come from IFRS. Okay, so I will share with you a very interesting factor. Before this amendment, before this modification, what we were doing, suppose I was buying a plant, let's say a plant for, let's say, 77 lakh. There's an example which I have given. I have bought a plant at 77 lakh rupees. Okay. Now, I had a choice from two vendors. One vendor was offering me at 77 lakhs. The other vendor was offering me at 70 lakhs. Now, what is the difference between the terms of these two vendors? The same product, but one at 77, the other at 70 lakhs. What is the difference in the terms? A 70 lakh fellow was telling me, pay me immediate or within 60 days of the credit period. So I have to pay the money immediately. I do not have a credit, huge credit. Maybe 60 days is a normal credit period. 77 lakh while I'm saying, okay, I will give you more credit. I will give you 6 months or 1 year deferment plan. You can pay me 77 lakhs over a period of 12 months. Or maybe whatever terms you have agreed, but it is over a period of time. It is not 2 months, or it is normal credit of 60 days is not applicable. It is a longer period. It is a deferred credit period. Now here, you see the difference in the price. I am paying 70 lakhs where I have to pay immediately. I am paying 77 lakhs. I'm getting a credit. We are all chartered accountants. I don't have to tell you what is the 7 lakhs. It is a pure interest. But what we were doing earlier before this amendment has happened, in both the cases, we were debiting 77 or 70 as a cost of that asset. We were never bifurcating interest component out of this because it was not required. The standard never required you to do it. IFRS requires you to break down that particular cost into two components. Cash price component is 70 lakhs. So you debit to your cost of assets. The 7 lakh, which is the interest component, you cannot say it's a cost of my asset. It is my interest or a finance cost, and it should be debited to my profit and loss account unless it requires capitalization as per the borrowing cost standard. If your that particular asset takes more than 12 months to come into place, then of course you have a choice of capitalizing. But generally, when you are buying an asset outright basis, there is no question of capitalization. It has to go to the profit and loss. 7 lakhs has to go to profit and loss as an interest. Now see the difference. 77 earlier was going as a PPE, which was going and sitting in your fixed cost, fixed assets. Now 70 lakh going and sitting in your fixed assets. 7 lakh is hitting your profit and loss account. Now see your impact on your profit and loss. It's true and fair. So suppose if you are not to comply with the standard and you are still debiting 77 lakh as your fixed assets, your profit and loss is absolutely wrong. Suppose you have made a profit of 1 lakh during the year and the 7 lakhs is missed out. If you had applied this standard, your loss would have been 6 lakhs, not 1 lakh profit. Now you can imagine profit becomes loss just because you have not complied with the standard. So if your financial statements have been signed as 1 lakh profit, is it true and fair? Anybody who has given loan based on this or you have made an investment based on this is going to sue you for the wrong information. So this is the seriousness of this accounting standard. Your true and fair depends on how you comply with it. It's very simple. The compliance is not very difficult, but you should know and you should apply this mind. And logically you are right, and that is the right way. You cannot say 7 lakhs is my cost of the asset because it is period cost, it is interest. There's a difference. Here I'm getting on payment, I'm getting 70 lakhs, do I 77 lakhs, it's a different thing. That 7 lakh I'm paying extra, although it is built in as a cost of that asset, it is not separately bifurcating that 7 lakh is my interest and 70 lakh is my cost. He's saying my price is 77 lakh, but in substance, 7 lakh what you are paying is interest, and the accounting standard deal with substance, not with the form. This is very, very important principle. Don't go by the form of the content of the bill. Don't go by the what is mentioned in the agreement. Don't go by what is mentioned in the bill. See what is the substance in that particular transaction. If there is an interest component in that, split it out interest and bring it out 7 lakh rupees to pay profit and loss account, which is actually the correct way of disclosure. That is what is required now under AS 10 PPE, which is in line with IFRS. And that is the reason we are saying that we will have to comply with the AS 10 properly. When an asset is exchanged for non-monetary asset, I think this was already there earlier, so there is nothing major. Cost measure at fair value unless exchange. Because if you are exchanging two assets, let's say I've got one mobile and somebody else has got another mobile, and I say, I like your mobile. You want to take my mobile or... No, a car. Okay, I have got one car and you have got some another car. We can exchange over each other's car and not pay each other, or maybe pay some small price for that each other. There is a barter and there is no actual payment of outflow of funds, but there is a change in the asset. So you will have to reflect that asset at the fair value of the asset exchange. Now, suppose if you have several items of PPE you buy at a consolidated price. I pay 1 crore rupees and I buy in package. That package may consist of computers, some plant and furniture. Okay, I said everything I want, whatever is there in this room, I want it. And I'm paying you, let's say, 10 lakh rupees for that price for that. Sometimes you do a wholesale bargain purchase, and in that you don't bifurcate when you make the payment. You said, okay, whatever it is that I will pay for 10 lakhs. Now, when you are accounting in the books, you can't say 10 lakhs all asset. What khichdi? It is all khichra. So what you do is you will have to bifurcate. Okay, by plant so much, computers so much, because ultimately you have to depreciate separately. You can't depreciate together 10 lakhs because computers have a useful life which is different. Plant will have a different useful life. The motor car may be having useful, different furniture will have a different useful life. So you can't say 10 lakh rupees all consolidated assets. No, you can't do that. We'll have to bifurcate into various components of the asset based on their fair market value. Whatever is their fair market value, you do that proportion and allocate. Suppose if there is a grant which you have received, then you have a choice of reducing that from the cost of an asset. As per section even 43 also, that WDV cost of an asset, you can do that. Measurement after recognition. This I said first recognition always at the cost, which is assuming it is a fair value. It is always at the fair value, so it is recognized at the cost. Subsequently, let's say for example you acquired an asset somewhere in December. Now you are coming to the year end March, and now you have a choice. You recognize this whatever asset is recognized already in the financial statement. At what price are you going to carry forward? You have a choice. Either you can follow the cost method and continue at a cost, whatever is the cost minus the depreciation, or you can revaluate as per the present market value of that asset. Now, revaluation has to be done as per the proper certificate valuation of some experts in that field. Now, you know, we have to be very careful who's expert. Suppose when you are doing a valuation of a building, don't go to an engineer who's a mechanical engineer. Go to a civil engineer or an architect or a person who is qualified in building. That person should be qualified in that field. Then only you can see. Sometimes I observed that the chartered accountant giving certificate that this is a fair value of the building, it is absolutely wrong. We are not supposed to give because we are not experts. We will stick to what we are expert in. We will go into accounting standard. We will go into that. That is our expertise. You don't start certifying something where you are not an expert. I have seen some certificates signed by a chartered accountant where they are not competent to certify something. And that is absolutely wrong, and they will be held for disciplinary action because they are going beyond their scope. Has anybody in our CA course studied how to building is built, how the structure of the building is built, how to value building? You don't know. There are so many complexities of the building. What is the useful life? How much structural strength it has got? All the things you have to see. You cannot just certify like that. So don't get into it. Whoever is the expert, get a certificate from them. And that we should also evaluate whether that person is really capable of giving that certificate. That is again our auditing standard, relying on certificate of an expert. You have to see whether that somebody when he's junior person certifying has no value. You have to see whether that person is of a standing, which he has got an understanding and knowledge of that subject, and he can certify correctly because you are relying on that particular. So your true and fair is based on that certificate because the depreciation, everything is worked out based on that. So you have to be very careful whom you rely on. You cannot just rely on anybody. Quick piece of paper to sign karke de diya hai, and you said, okay, I am a so and so, but whether he is competent, he might be a qualified person, but he may not be competent enough to give that certificate. So you should see what is the standing, whether he has the ability to certify this paper. If it is a machinery, you should be some mechanical engineer who is qualified, be mechanical, who is qualified in that particular area and who can certify, yes, this is the value of that particular machine. So these are all the aspects. I suppose if it is computer, and computer specialist or computer qualified person who has got a degree in computer electronics, That person can certify. A mechanical engineer will not be able to certify a computer because he has got no competence on computer. So you have to be very careful what you are going to rely on. And again, as I said earlier also, if you are going to value it, it has to be the entire class of the assets. You cannot pick and choose, okay, I will do only this asset valuation. No, it has to be full class. Another thing, earlier also these revaluations were there in our AS10. It was not that it is something new, but there is a change. What is the change? Earlier, suppose there is a very old entity. You have done a revaluation, let's say in 1990. You can forget after that. Earlier, AS10 mein koi compulsion nahi tha ke regularly revalue karna hai. Okay, there was no compulsion. You have done it in 1990. You can continue that same figure for 2020, 20, 30, 40. Continue. Nobody was telling you check whether revaluation is still valid. Because if you have revalued a building in 1990, what is the sanctity of it today? Suppose, for example, you bought a building for, let's say, 1 crore rupees. In 1990, that value was, let's say, 5 crore rupees. You have revalued at 5 crore. Today also you are continuing at 5 crore. It has lost its relevance of revaluation because that is no longer a market value. Neither it is cost. So it is in between. Neither it is cost nor it is a market value. Today in 2020 it might be fetching 20 crore. So 5 crore ka kya relevance hai? 20 crore. So what now the standard prescribes is that you should look at that particular asset. If it has got a high volatility of that value in market, then you should do it every year. But if it is not, then you can do it every 3 to 5 years, not 20 years, 30 years after. Okay, so because it has to live with the market trend. Okay, if that asset has gone up to 20 crore, you should bring it to 20 crore. Then it makes sense. When you're reading a balance sheet, if you're reading it at a 5 crore, what relevance? Neither it is at cost nor at market value. Market value is 20 crore. Kya meaning hai 5 crore ka? So you have to be, you apply your mind, you have a chartered accountant. We should think, and this is what standard provides. Logical, very logical. So you should evaluate every 3 to 5 years and see whether that particular asset is as per the market price. If not, get a revaluation then again after 3 to 5 years, depending on the volatility of the particular asset. If the asset is highly volatile, do it every year. Okay. Now, how do you revalue and what do you do it? You cannot credit any revaluation reserve difference. Suppose, for example, you bought the asset at 1 crore and now you're revaluing it 5 crore. 4 crore cannot go to profit and loss account. You will be inflating profit unnecessarily. No, it will be credited to revaluation reserve account. Okay? And only when you sell, that revaluation reserve will go to the profit loss because you have realized that profit or loss, whatever has happened after that. Actually, what has happened when that asset is sold out, that time you can bring it to the profit and loss account. Till that time, you cannot bring it to profit and loss account. It will continue as a revaluation reserve. And whatever is the extra depreciation you are going to charge will be debited to this revaluation reserve, not to the profit and loss account, because you can't say credit mein nahi le raha hun, lekin debit ja raha hai, that cannot happen. Okay. So extra depreciation because of the revaluation will go to the revaluation reserve, and whatever is the normal depreciation as per cost will go to the normal profit and loss account. So that is the rule. If you have got a major inspection cost, suppose you have the building or a plant where you require regular inspection, and if you have to spend money for inspection of that particular plant or building, then those costs will be capitalized and not written off to profit and loss account. And whatever was earlier debited to asset, what was inspection cost, will be written off to the profit and loss account after deducting depreciation, because you might have claimed depreciation on that. So you deduct after that. Now depreciation. This is very, very important. Earlier, the separate standard AS 6, now it has got merged with your AS 10. Depreciation, each part of an item of PPE, which is with a cost that is significant in relation to total cost, should be depreciated separately. Now, this is very important, very interesting. First of all, what does it mean? It means component accounting. It is now a new theory, new item coming up in your standard, which was not there earlier. And this is applicable to MSME also. It is not, no exemption is given. Now, what does it say? Suppose I bought one machine. That machine has got various parts. So far, what we have been doing, a machine, say, let's say useful life 15 years, you depreciate 15 years. The entire machine. Suppose I bought it machine at 5 lakh rupees. I'm going to depreciate this 5 lakh machine for 15 years. Now, there could be a significant component. Significant component means more than 10% of the cost or the carrying amount. So let's say if I bought it for 5 lakhs, so if any component which is costing more than 50,000 rupees, I must check whether each and every component of this particular machine, which is more than 50,000, whether its useful life also is 15 years. If yes, then fine. You do the total depreciation, no problem. But if it is not, suppose there are some components of this which is more than 50,000, which might require replacement every 5 years. That means the useful life is only 5 years. So you can't depreciate 15 years. You will have to depreciate that component for 5 years. Now, how are you going to remove it? Because your invoice says 5 lakh rupees machine. Now, you don't know what is the price of that component. It could be 60, it could be 70. You don't know, but it is more than 10%. You know that. Because you know, it is a very significant component, and tomorrow if I have to replace it, it will be very expensive. So, I'll give you a very simple example. A car. Of course, the tires, what I am giving you example, may not be more than 10%. So, you may not require to do it, but just for explaining this, I'm giving you the concept. For concept, I'm giving you the example. It may not be applicable in theory. Don't start doing that in your practice. A car will have a car and a tire. You all know car may last for 15 years, but the tires don't last for 15 years. You will have to replace it every 5 years or 6 years, depending on the usage. When you buy a car, you don't buy car tires separately. It is part of the package. 8 lakhs, 10 lakhs, whatever car purchase you have done. The tires wear out faster. Now you have to replace it. You don't depreciate separately. But now, if that tires were more than 10% of the cost of that car, you would have to depreciate separately based on its useful life. Okay. So the useful life of the car may be 15 years, but if that component is less than 15 years, then you will have to depreciate at a higher rate, higher amount to depreciate over its useful life. So similarly, now the challenge for us is how to work out this value. That is a challenge. Not that, okay, we can apply. Instead of 15 years, you apply 10 years, 5 years, fine. That is not an issue. But how do you work out? Because you never have the breakup. You have got this 5 lakh rupees of cost in the plan. You will have to find out what is a similar, suppose if you were to buy that component today from the market, what would be the price? Suppose if it is 50,000, 60,000. So that is the probable component cost of that particular thing. Carve out that from that 5 lakhs. Suppose if it is 50,000, then you take 4.5 lakh as the rest of the machine, and 50,000 is this component. 50,000 will be depreciated over 5 years. 4,50,000 will be depreciated over 15 years. So this will be the difference in your depreciation working. And I told you, if you are signing a financial statement, you will have to comply with this. You cannot ignore it. Because if you ignore it, then you are in big trouble. Now, which method, SLM, WDV, or unit of production is eligible, which we were earlier also applicable. So there is no change in this. You can continue to do this. If now, from where do you get useful life? Of course, for companies, corporates, you have a Schedule 2 which specifies useful life. You can use it. It does no harm. Because even though you're non-corporate, you can still use both for guidance. Because it specifies for a level of companies where useful life of each asset is prescribed. So you can say in your notes to account that we have used useful life of Schedule 2 as prescribed under a Companies Act for purpose of this financial statement, no harm, because it is already prescribed for a particular level of people, although it may not be applicable to you, but you can always take guidance from that. So rate of depreciation, how do you work out? You say, okay, total whatever is the cost minus the salvage value, and then you allocate over the minimum 5% should be the salvage value, and work out what is the balance amount it should be written off over a period of its useful life. 5%, the last residual value, you need not depreciate. You stop there and continue it in your balance sheet as well. If there is a change in the accounting depreciation method, suppose from straight line to WDV or WDV to straight line, earlier we were doing retrospective. I mean, now it is not required. It's a change in accounting policy. It's a prospective effect. So that is again another change in that. Useful life of an asset or residual value of an asset is reviewed each financial year, and if expectations differ, you have to change. Suppose, for example, I had estimated 15 years, but then next year I find, no, this particular asset will not last for more than 5 years or 10 years. I will revise the useful life, and it is a change in the accounting estimate and not a past. You don't have to give effect of the past. Do it prospectively. Don't go and change anything in the past. Past, whatever was done is correct. Change in existing decommissioning, restoration, or reliability. Suppose when I'm acquiring an asset and I know that I have to do something later on when I am dismantling this asset, I have to make a provision to it. I cannot wait for that last day. So I have to make a provision, and that provision has to be kept in the books. Okay. Now, impairment, of course, there is a standard on that, AS-28. I'm not getting into it because somebody might be dealing with that standard later on. Now, I just share with you two aspects here. What is the difference between depreciation and impairment loss? Tomorrow, somebody may say, oh, I'm providing depreciation. Why do I need to work out the impairment loss? But no, it is required. There is a vast difference between impairment and depreciation. I will explain you in very short example. See, I have got an asset, okay? And that asset can produce goods for 15 years. So that asset has to be depreciated over its useful life, or that is 15 years. Now I have bought that asset in my plant, in my factory, and I started using it. For first 2 years, I start using it. It gives me production perfect, and it is still going to give me production. There is no harm. The machine is fit and fine, and it will produce goods in 15 years. So I'm now depreciating it over a period of its useful life. So that is depreciation, because it is depreciating in terms of its wear and tear. Now, after 2 years, I was getting very good orders and I was getting business, so the machine was kept busy. After 2 years comes COVID. The company, the customers who were giving me orders have gone into problems and they are not having business. So they are not giving me orders for that particular product, or there is some change in technology because of which I'm not getting orders for that particular product. I have got a machine which has a capacity to produce, but I don't have orders. What do I do? Machine is lying idle in my factory. Then, although it has a capacity to produce, it cannot produce because I don't have orders. Why would I produce all goods and keep it in my factory? I have to sell. Now I can't sell, so I don't produce. Now, is it a fault of the machine? No, but it's a fact, yes, that I cannot produce. So that machine has changed in value in use. Its value as per its useful life is there. I can use it for 15 years, but I can't use, I don't have orders. So value in use has reduced drastically. So I have to evaluate. Now I'm carrying this. Suppose I bought this machine for 5 lakhs and I have already depreciated for 2 years at, let's say, 50,000 rupees, and it is showing in my books at a carrying amount of 4.5 lakhs. Now, whether this 4.5 lakh asset is useful for me? Is this a carrying amount correct? No, because it is not yielding the output and the sales and the profit which is required to get me that business. So what do? I will have to provide for an impairment loss and reduce the value of this 4.5 lakh to a level which is realizable. Value in use. I will have to bring it down to value in use. Suppose maybe I assume that for 2 years this problem will continue. And after 3rd year, I will continue to get orders. So I estimate for 5 years my cash flow from that particular thing. I discount it today's value. And if I find that yes, the value instead of 4.5 lakh should be 3 lakh rupees. The useful value of this particular asset, so I impair it by 1.5 lakh. I continue in the book at 3 lakh rupees. And if I feel that no, I will not be able to get anything except the scrap value, then I'll bring it down to the scrap value, which may be 50,000 rupees. So this is what this is called impairment. It has nothing to do with depreciation. Is a different aspect altogether. Okay. So impairment is as per AS 28. I'm not getting into it because it's a separate standard by itself and can be discussed later. Retirement is when the asset is either sold or, you know, it is removed from the active use, and when it is sold out, the WDV has to be removed from the asset value, and the profit or loss has to be recognized in the P&L account. If there is a revaluation, it has to be transferred to the profit and loss. Derecognition means that when it is sold and now it is no longer available to the company for economic benefit. Gain or loss on derecognition has to be debited to profit and loss account. Now, this is one very interesting component account. This is probably the last part of the discussion today, and then we will go into question and answer. What is component accounting? We discussed initially regarding depreciating assets based on its useful life components. Now, this is a similar concept, but slightly different. This again has come from IFRS. This was not there under our AS 10 earlier. This has come from IFRS. Now it is there in Ind AS, and it has come into our AS 10 also. Now, what is the component accounting? Suppose what you were doing earlier. Suppose, for example, I am, you know, speaking to you from my computer. It happens that my computer works fine for, let's say, another 5-6 years. But within 2 years or 3 years, because I am using it so extensively, the monitor gets conked. So I call one computer engineer and says, okay, I will replace this monitor, and it will charge me some 5,000, 10,000, whatever for the monitor. I bought that computer for, let's say, 50,000 rupees, and today he's charging me 10,000 for the monitor. As per earlier AS 10, this 10,000 was going as a replacement, repairs and replacement cost in my profit and loss. That we all knew. We were doing it earlier also. And my that original cost continues in the books, and they get depreciated. Although the monitor has changed, there is a new monitor has come in. The old monitor has been replaced, but the asset continues and WDV continues, and that whatever cost of the replacement has been debited to profit and loss. This is not correct, or this is now changed. Why it has changed? I will explain why it has changed and what is the change. What are we supposed to do now? What has actually happened one part of this particular computer, which is material, of course, don't go in for small nuts and bolts. I'm not talking about nuts and bolts. I'm talking about a substantial part. And a computer monitor is a substantial portion of a computer. This monitor is being scrapped, removed, because it is not working. Okay. This was there in my PP. It has to come out. It has not come out as per the earlier one. Whatever new thing has come has gone to the profit loss, which is a capital expenditure. It is not, it is going to be used for more than 1 year. So it should have been capitalized, but it has not been capitalized. Now what we have to do, the cost which you have incurred for replacement of this particular monitor will be added to the cost of the computer. Naturally, you cannot keep adding and then the asset will keep on adding. No, it cannot happen. Whatever was already there in the books, the WDV, written down value of that monitor, in that cost of the computer will have to be written off in profit and loss account. You can't say you keep on adding to the cost. No, that is not correct again. It is not true and fair. So what? How do you do it? Now the challenge again is how do you do it? So what we will do it, 10,000 rupees, whatever I spend for monitor will be added to the cost of the computer, not as a PA profit and loss account, but cost of computer, not as a repairs and replacement, but as a cost of the computer. And the written down value, which is ingrained in this computer, which I bought say 2 years ago at the 50,000 rupees depreciated today. Now, not what is the total value of computer, but what is the monitor value in that now? The challenge is how do you find out? Because you got a bill of one laptop, one computer, which is 50,000 rupees. You never got a split. Okay, monitor so much, this hard disk so much. No, you never got the bill like that. So how do you find out? We have taken some guidance from IFRS. There is a guidance, you know, given in how to implement IFRS. There is a guidance. So from there, I have taken this guidance, how to do it. Very simple. When I bought this computer at 50,000, that time the monitor was costing, let's say, 5,000. That means it's a 10% of the cost of the computer. Okay. That means I can know that this monitor was 10 at that time, 10% of this. Today, suppose I'm buying this monitor at 10,000, what is the cost? Suppose if it is 1 lakh, that 10%. So I know what is the 10%. So I apply the same percentage to that 50,000 and I say work out 10%. And that 5,000 rupees depreciate till date for 2 years, whatever rate I've applied. And let's say it comes down to 4,000. So 4,000 I will debit to profit and loss account. And 10,000 I will debit to the cost of the asset. Now, all these adjustments are not tax deductible. Please understand, you will have to add back for the tax purposes because this is not a tax deductible expense. Okay. Earlier, that replacement cost was a tax deductible expense, but now this will not be taxable. It's a capital expenditure. And what you have written off is also not tax deductible because you have claimed depreciation on that. So you cannot get the deduction. It is a, so you, of course, block may be zero. There is no question of any debt. You can continue to claim depreciation in your income tax block because it cannot come out of the block. Okay, it will remain in the block. So from the purpose of accounting, you have to pass this entry. From income tax perspective, you will not get deduction of 10,000. That's the only thing. Okay. So this is called component accounting. Now, this is similarly in aircraft where the airframe, engineer, interior, they have different values and components. And if there is a replacement of those big, huge parts of the aircraft, then this component accounting will come into. So this I have already explained, but again, so this is all as far as the AS 10 is concerned. If you have any queries, I will be glad to take it up.
Thank you very much, Kusai sir. There are a few queries. Yeah. So I'll just read one by one for you.
No problem.
The first query is, are accounting standard issued by MCA applicable to Section 8 companies, or still we have to follow AS issued by ICAI?
It is a company under a Companies Act. So you will have to comply with the MS Companies Act standard, not by ICAI. Because it is not a non-corporate. It is a corporate. And it is incorporated in Section Companies Act itself. Only what is applicable to non-corporate is what is not under a Companies Act.
Okay. Second question is, Section 8 company received an immovable property as gift from promoter. How to account for it? How to account for stamp duty paid on it?
Very, very interesting question. See, during, it's not only next Section 8 company, in your real life also, in other non Section 8 companies also receive certain assets as a without any consideration. Like, for example, government allots some land for certain, as a government grant. Okay, this is something which you can construct your building for purpose of some development. Similarly, you may also get a gift from your promoter or anybody for your this. So there are, you cannot bring it at fair value, because first and what is our first criteria? Recognize that cost. You cannot bring it at fair value. But what you can do is bringing it at 1 rupee in the book, so that at least it is nominally recognized in the asset. And then you can revalue on the 31st March when the subsequent recognition at the fair market value, that option you already have. But when initial recognition, always it has to be cost. Now there is no cost here, but you can always bring it at 1 rupee, which is as a nominal value, which is permissible under AS 12 as a government grant. There is no such mention in AS 10 about it, but in AS 12 it says that when you get something free as a gift, as a grant, you can bring it at a nominal value at 1 rupee and recognize that to at least show that there is an asset in the books, to recognize that asset. And then, of course, you have a choice in the subsequent period to value at the fair market value and the revaluation model.
Okay. Sir, now I have one query. In your presentation, you had taken that example of buying the machinery of that 70 lakh and yes. 77 lakh example you had taken. Now, when we are doing auditing, let's say, how do we come to know what is the interest portion? Because client just has one bill, and it's not like a cooperative society where they are taking maybe three quotations and we can compare those. So then how do we determine what is the interest cost?
Absolutely. See, now, first and foremost, how do you do it? First, suppose, for example, if the purchases are at a normal credit period of 30 days, 60 days, which is a normal credit period, you need not even go into the question that is a cost. But the moment you come across a purchase, which is of a deferred credit, 6 months, 12 months. Now, see, in the standard, it does not say any such specified period, that 3 months, 6 months or 12 months, what is the period? But if for a longer period in the normal credit, what is a normal credit for when you buy machine? You get 30 days, maybe you have to pay immediate, or maybe maximum 30 days you get credit. So that is a normal credit period. But if you get something elongated, like 6 months deferred credit or 1 year deferred credit, then what you do is ask your client to get a similar quotations of a similar product from the same manufacturer, or from some another manufacturer of a similar good, that okay, what will be my cash price if I pay you payment immediately? And if you get a price which is lower than whatever has been quoted here, then the difference will be the cash component, the interest component.
So
you do documentation, paperwork has to be there to justify how you have worked out this interest component.
Okay. There is one more query, sir. It says, till now fixed asset depreciated under income tax rates. Now, do we have to recheck asset life and account for depreciation, and does have two different fixed asset and depreciation charts from this year onwards?
Absolutely, sir. That is what was required earlier also, but many people were not following it. They were saying, okay, as per income tax act, but that was not correct right from day one. It is not today any changes happen. But I'm just bringing the awareness today that it is required, and I am observing this many financial statements I get from various chartered accountants, and I'm observing that they write in the notes account that depreciation is as per income tax act, and all what the figures match, whatever is claimed in the block method and what is mentioned in the this, it matches. So I know that it is as per the income tax act, which is not correct, which is not as per useful life and not complying with the accounting standard 10. So, we are non-complying with the standard. So you should have a different, now how do you allocate? Now it was a block, Khichdi hai pura. We'll have to probably work out some method and allocate. What I do is, I will tell you how I advise our client. Suppose, for example, you have got a book value, let's say 1 crore rupees, which is as per income tax act block method. Now you'll take a list of all the assets that we have got as of now. Let's say you have got 20 assets. Ask somebody who is an expert in that particular area to value that market value. Suppose you come to 2 crore. Now you have got in the book value, let's say 1 crore, and you have got the valuation is 2 crore individually asset-wise. Simply, whatever is the value mentioned, you make 50% of that and bring it in the book value. So at least now you know that this is the value of all the assets and start depreciating them. Now you will not have the cost, because this company entity might be, if you are able to work it out, very nice. But if it is a very old entity and if it's all so many years of accumulation and you cannot identify each asset. And this is the way, and you can give a note that this is a starting point and we have done this. Subsequently, it will correct it.
The query regarding the gift which I had asked you, the same member has again asked, in above question of gift, how to account for stamp duty? I suppose
if the stamp duty is paid, then it is a cost. Yeah. If you acquired this asset and you have paid stamp duty, it is a cost. So you have ₹1 and plus whatever is the cost of the stamp duty.
Because again he has stated that stamp duty is paid by Section 8 company. So obviously it will be a cost and we will add it.
Yes, absolutely.
I think queries are over. So thanks a lot.
I have one query.
Tell me.
This component account is compulsory even for the MSMEs?
Yeah, there is no exemption. I am not.
There is no exemption. Okay.
I am not. See, exemption is only for those three disclosures. Disclosures which I mentioned. So there is no exemption. Now, unless they come out with some further exemptions, we don't know. So far, there is no exemption.
This component is going to be a challenging job for them.
Very challenging. Absolutely. Compared to the disclosure, this is more challenging. Disclosure is still possible. So, I mean, I'm sure ICAI will work on it.
Okay. So, thanks a lot, Kusai sir, for sparing your time and addressing our members of our study circle on this accounting standard in very lucid manner. And actually, after going through your presentation and hearing you, we realize how challenging it would be really to comply with this component accounting or maybe working out the interest portion and other things. So thanks a lot. And I, on behalf of the entire study circles and members of our study circle, once again, thank you for addressing us. And it was fun hearing you. Friends, thanks. Friends, before we end this session, I once again reiterate and make an appeal to all members to come ahead and contact either me, Parag sir, or Dhungre sir, if you are willing to do presentation on any topic of interest or importance for our profession. Because as Dhungre sir said in yesterday's meeting, it was rightly pointed out by Chitay sir that study circle can be the first stage where new members can come ahead and start addressing our own members and maybe develop the habit of giving presentations and so on. They can start addressing other study circles as well. So if anybody of you are interested in giving presentation on any of the topics, do contact us. Thanks a lot. Have a good day. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.